Among all the agencies of civilization which have worked for the advancement, the comfort, and the prosperity of mankind, transportation stands foremost. From a prehistoric day when some cave dweller fashioned a rude wheel to move himself, his family, and his goods more easily from place to place, transportation has been civilization's keystone through all the ages. The most efficient and economical means of transportation ever developed is the modern steam railroad system. And although a steam locomotive had not been conceived in the mind of man, and railroad tracks had not even been dreamed of at the time our story begins, yet we're going to show you how a great American laid the foundations for one of the world's greatest railroads, and securely fixed a young nation in its place in the world with the bonds of transportation. On a bright spring day almost 200 years ago, this young American stood on a lofty windswept peak on the crest of the Blue Ridge Mountains and conjured what lay beyond in the boundless, unknown West. A surveyor, fearless and sturdy. His name, George Washington. Surveying the millions of acres inherited by Lord Fairfax from his mother, Lady Culpepper, he had blazed trails through the silences of the dark forests, scaled rocky peaks, and slept under the stars. While he was peering beyond the curtain which screened the great country before him, huge unseen forces were in motion to change the map of the world. No doubt it was during those early days of surveying, roaming, and horseback riding that a dream of a route of travel over the mountains had its birth in the mind of this young man. Days of youth passed to years of young manhood, and he began to take on the responsibilities for which nature had fitted him. As a colonel of colonial militia, he protected outlying settlements and fought off savage marauders, carrying the flag of his king over these same mountains to dislodge the French from Fort Duquesne, on the site where Pittsburgh now stands. When the great struggle for American independence came, he led the embattled colonists through the hard-won victories and bitter defeats, which ended with the acknowledgement by all the world that the American colonies were and ought to be free and independent states. Hailed by the great as one of the foremost generals of all time, and acclaimed by the world as one of its greatest men, he refused a crown, and turning to the pursuits of peace, devoted himself to building a new nation. Along the Atlantic seaboard lay the original 13 colonies, a nation in swaddling clothes. And over the mountains lay the frontier outposts carved from the forest by the hardy pioneers who braved the barbarian in the wilderness. Their lands were coveted by Britain, Spain, and France, each seeking a new empire, all seeking to stunt the lusty child just born. George Washington, looking westward again, saw clearly that unless the bonds of transportation held the advanced outposts of civilization to their mother colonies, they surely would slip away to foreign domination. Thus did George Washington become the father of transportation in America. Thus did he conceive the foundation of a great railroad. Let us listen while Governor Harrison of Virginia reads to Patrick Henry and other leaders of the new state George Washington's letter in 1784.
The flanks and rear of the United States are possessed by other powers. It is necessary to apply the cement of interest to bind all parts of the Union together with indissoluble bonds. The Western settlers have no other means of coming to us except by long land transportation and unimportant roads. But smooth the road and make easy the way for them, and see how amazingly our exports will be increased and how amply we shall be compensated for the trouble and expense of effecting.
In the meantime, Washington had sent Andrew Lewis, one of his revolutionary leaders and Indian fighters, to survey a road over the mountains, the Midland Trail of today. It was only a rough wagon road, winding from the lowlands of the seaboard country, along the steep slopes of the Blue Ridge, through the precipitous passes of the Alleghenies, and down into the verdant fields of the Ohio River Basin. Over its rutted path, westward, the course of empire made its way. Virginia Assembly, at Washington's urging, passed a law creating the James River Company, which came into being in 1785 to clear the streams for navigation, build canals around waterfalls, cut roads over mountaintops, and connect with streams and roads to the west. Washington was elected the first president of the James River Company, which was the original predecessor company of Chesapeake and Ohio Line. He was one of its original stockholders. Some of its old canal beds still survive, unused for transportation, because progress had found a better way. 25 years after George Washington had passed to the immortals, the steam locomotive made its appearance. Railroads sprang up along the old routes of travel. Small, scattered short lines were built and then hooked together. The Richmond and Allegheny Railroad took over all the rights of way and appurtenances of the James River Company, and George Washington's canal became a railroad. Other lines built along the route of the Midland Trail were extended, then combined. And finally, all found their way into the Chesapeake and Ohio lines of today. George Washington's railroad, built on the routes he selected. And here we see George Washington's railroad as it is today, smoothing the road, making easy the way between east and west, as Washington predicted in his letter to Governor Harrison. The main line, starting at Cincinnati to the west, receives their travel and commerce coming in through cars without change from the great northwest, the west, and the southwest. And then winds eastward through the beautiful Ohio River Valley. From Louisville and Lexington, the Kentucky Division brings travel and commerce from the Mississippi Valley states. These lines join at Ashland, Kentucky, to pass on to Huntington and Charleston, West Virginia, and on through the marvelous New River Gorge, over the Allegheny Mountains to White Sulphur Springs and Virginia Hot Springs, two of the world's most famous playgrounds. Then on to Clifton Forge, Virginia. Here between Ashland and Clifton Forge is a stretch of the Midland Trail, George Washington's wagon road. And here at Clifton Forge is the James River, the route of George Washington's canal. On through the beautiful Blue Ridge Mountain country, the line runs to Charlottesville, rightfully named Heart of the Empire. From Charlottesville, one line goes on to Washington, D.C., sending its through cars forward to Baltimore, Philadelphia, and New York. While the other line turns southward from Charlottesville to enter Richmond, Newport News, and Norfolk. From Detroit, Toledo, and Cleveland, a newer but no less important part of the line sends its travel and commerce down to join the rails at Ashland. And here you see George Washington's railroad as it stands today, built on the foundations laid by Washington himself 150 years ago. Now we're going to take you for a trip over the principal parts of George Washington's railroad. You're going to travel the very ground he trod. You're going to see where he was born, where he lived and died. You're going to stand where he stood when he won the independence of the United States. And you're going to see the great city whose site he chose.